slash Mumbai, and then joined there as a faculty member. He has mentored a number of students, 16, and at some stage, 1992, he moved from KIFR to IUCAA in Pune, where he continues to this day. I won't stand between you and him by going through the list of honors that he has received. So,
making this happen. So before I actually start and introduce to you what I am going to talk and then get on with the first lecture, I want to get some feedback about the composition of the audience. To begin with, how many of you here attended the lecture series last time which I gave? Okay, fine. Then is there anyone here in the audience who do not know Maxwell's equations? Oh, fantastic. Okay, so then I can go a bit more faster. Is there anyone here who do not know a little bit of special relativity, very little, like Lorentz transformation, c square dt square minus dx square, stuff like that? Fine. That is the background I need. With that background, I promise to take you all through theoretical physics. And if time permits, even to something like, you know, black hole evaporating through Hawking radiation, etc., etc. So one of the main purposes of this, there are several purposes for this lecture, but let me try to describe them one by one. One of the main purposes is that most of the concepts, and in fact a fair number of them, which people believe are very advanced, and innocent kids should not be exposed to it, sort of adults only subject, is not so advanced and can be taught at a fairly elementary level. So I will try to prove that as we go along. Second, if you look at the standard physics coaching in any institute, university, ICER, etc., there is a very standard and well-defined procedure which is adopted all over. You sort of do classical mechanics, classical electrodynamics, special relativity, then maybe statistical mechanics and condensed matter and kinetic theory, and then you move on to general relativity, then quantum mechanics somewhere along the line, and quantum field theory, and you may go to higher and higher levels depending on how long you persist with it. Now this is very good and this is very structured, because this kind of coaching is intended for people who need exits at different levels. For example, you may be basically interested in biology, but you want to know some amount of physics. And there is no point in teaching you general relativity if that is your ultimate aim. And there could be people who actually want to do chemistry, but they need a bit of physics. Or experimental physicists who want to work with lasers. So that is how this structure has evolved, and people need this exit path. My lectures are intended for people who are fascinated by theoretical physics. And even though they may take an exit at some stage, they would like to know what is the whole business of theoretical physics is about, and how it goes along. Okay, so I'm not going to in fact, nature does not work semester by semester. Nature does not first do classical mechanics, then do quantum mechanics, etc. Nature is fully general relativistic and it is fully quantum mechanical, and then you start with a quantum mechanical system and we humans classicalize it. You never quantize a classical system. Nature never does that. Nature starts with a quantum system and we classicalize it for our facilitation. So the approach which I am going to take is going to be very holistic, and you will see that right from the beginning. And the word action in the title was little bit of a gimmick, in the sense that you will find that probably through most of today's lecture I will never use action, and there is a reason for that, and that you will see in the next lecture. The second point is that unless you take such a holistic view of physics, you actually don't understand things at a deeper level. Now, I don't know how many of you are actually familiar with action. You don't have to, because I will be introducing that. For example, some elementary things like why action is kinetic energy minus potential energy actually requires both quantum mechanics and general relativity for its justification. That might sound very surprising and even absurd, but I'll show it to you. Okay, so if you really want to understand it at a deeper level, you need that. And the second point which I will try to emphasize all along the course is that the more exact your theory is, as we understand it, the more beautiful it gets. The more beautiful, the more logical, and the more, in some sense, easier to grasp. This is contrary to what textbooks will tell you. Textbooks will start with ladders sliding on the walls and balls rolling on the inclined plane, and will tell you that these are very elementary things where you develop your physics intuition. I never understood that these physics intuition you develop in it, which is all very good and it's nice to solve these problems, is ever going to help you to understand the higher echelons of physics. Okay? So the kind of intuition you need that is very different. So the purpose of this lecture is to let you develop that intuition as well. So we will not be afraid of what are advanced topics and what are elementary topics. We will not semesterize nature. We will not talk about classical mechanics, quantum mechanics, GR, etc. separately. But this is going to be an entire approach to understand the structure of theoretical physics as we know today, to the extent we can in 6 hours. Okay? So that is going to be the purpose of the course. So one way of introducing this, which is my favorite, is to look at what I call the cube of physics. Okay, so let me draw this here. So I want to start with 3 axes. So here is 1, 2, 3 and a quadrant. And I actually want a cube. So let me try to draw a cube to the extent I can. Imagine that this is some kind of a unit cube. Okay, this axis is labeled by Newtonian constant G, Newtonian gravitational constant G. This axis I will label by C inverse. This is 1 pi speed of light. And this axis I am going to label by H cross. Now there is mass light. Yeah. I'll try. Okay. One possibility is you come here. There are a lot of seats in the front row. Okay? In fact, you people can move forward if this is going to be a problem, because I will try but I may not. Okay? So, since we have 3 dimensions, mass, light and ML, and mass, length and time, you can set these 3 constants to unity. So think of them as 1, 1, 1 here, and they are 0 here. So we, as we move along this direction, we are switching on H cross, and of course only these 2 points are important. When we go from here to here, we have switched on G. When you go from here to here, we have switched on C inverse. So C inverse being equal to 0 is equal to C being infinity. That is when the effects of C are not there. Most of the physics you start with in your first semester or whatever lives here. You don't have special relativity and you don't talk about quantum mechanics, you don't worry about C and you don't worry about H cross. And pretty quickly you will start moving from here along this direction. You will introduce Newtonian gravity. So I'll put NG here. So this is the kind of thing when you study planets going around the sun or balls being sent as a projectile and classical mechanics, so to speak. So the elementary, classical, non-relativistic, non-quantum mechanics lives on this line. Then somewhere along the line, somebody will come and tell you that these equations of motion which you learned in classical mechanics is all wrong. No, they won't tell you all wrong, because in physics we are very polite people. We will say approximate. What it means is it is wrong. Okay? So it is not quite right. So there is something called speed of light, and depending on the value of the velocity with which the particles are moving, etc., there are corrections from relativity. So you add that along and you get here what I will call special relativity. Now along this line, you also can learn the entire electrodynamics. So I will just put ED here. There are textbooks, pretty horrible ones, in which electrodynamics will be introduced by Gauss law and various other things, and special relativity come in chapters 15 as an afterthought. Try not to read them. So the proper way to think of electrodynamics is an offshoot of special relativity. So this is special relativity and electrodynamics linked together. Just as you have Newtonian gravity coming from what I would have called classical mechanics. So you have Newtonian gravity in this direction, special relativity and electrodynamics already taken care of in this direction. You try to combine special relativity with Newtonian gravity. This is what Einstein did, and you end up getting what is known as GR. So GR sits at this vertex. This entire plane is the plane of classical physics. Okay? And in fact, I will describe what the actual mathematics behind the classical physics is pretty simple. And compared to what is going to come, it is almost trivial. Okay? So this plane has Newtonian gravity, general relativity, special relativity, classical mechanics, and electrodynamics. Then another professor will tell you that everything here is wrong, and there is something called quantum mechanics, and you switch on this H cross. So in order to make life simple, you will switch on the constants one by one. So you switch on from here H cross, from this classical mechanics, you end up getting quantum mechanics. This is QM. More precisely, non-relativistic quantum mechanics. I should have written NRQM, but this is the QM which you study. Now this QM is along this axis, and suppose I forget about gravity and I switch on special relativity. Then you are combining quantum mechanics with special relativity, and you end up getting what is known as quantum field theory. I told you that this plane is the entire plane of classical physics. It has a good pedigree, and this was all we had around 1900 before the quantum revolution took place. Of course, at 1900 we didn't have special relativity, but we already had electrodynamics and Newtonian gravity, and then came special relativity and GR. Similarly, this plane here, if you just forget gravity, this plane contains the entire understanding we have of what is called the standard model of particle physics. Okay, so if you use the concept of quantum field theory, which incorporates special relativity and quantum mechanics, you can describe the material world fairly well. Already at this end, you have described all of chemistry. Okay, all of chemistry lives here, and with a little bit of this added together, biology, biophysics, geology, everything is covered. Then if you go much deeper into the particle physics, and if you want to understand the standard model of particle physics, what the world is made of, quarks, gluons, elementary particles, etc., they all live in essentially this plane. Okay? With more interaction than just electrodynamics thrown in, and none of them requires gravity. So you set that gravitational constant to zero and you work in this plane. Now you can do two more things. You can combine this quantum mechanics with Newtonian gravity. So I will call this, let us see, GQM. This is gravitational quantum mechanics. So you will notice that every vertex I have labeled, you will find in ICER syllabus book. You will find SR, GR, ED, CM, Newtonian gravity. And if you go to advanced topics, definitely QM and possibly QFT. You wouldn't find this. This is highly underrepresented. It's a beautiful area of subject. And in fact, in the early next lecture or late today's lecture, we will touch upon this. We will use this in order to get some valuable insight. So here what we are saying is that the quantum mechanics is switched on, but gravity is not very strong. Gravity is still very weak, so you don't need general relativity. You can work with Newtonian gravity. Okay, so this is one vertex which you are not going to find in textbooks, but I will tell you a few things about it. Then you take that and you combine it with GR, that is you add the speed of light, that is you combine this with special relativity. So this is the ultimate holy grail of physics. We haven't reached there, so let me just cut a part of it off. We haven't quite reached that direction, so I have put a cross section there. So we know a few things here. In particular, we know what is called QFT in G. What do I mean by that? You don't quantize gravity, you treat gravity as given to you. So there is, let us say, a gravitational object, maybe a massive black hole, and you have a quantum field theory, not living in the absence of gravity but in the presence of gravity provided by this black hole. Then you can find very interesting phenomena, and one of them which I alluded to, that the black holes evaporate by emitting thermal radiation, which is a famous result from Stephen Hawking, sits here. This we understand. We don't quite understand quantum gravity, but these are the result in which G, H cross and C will appear in your formulas. So all the three of them are required here. Here G and H cross will appear but not C. And in quantum field theory in curved space-time or quantum field theory in the presence of gravity, you need this as well. Fine. So we have this entire structure built here, and now we want to dissect them and look at each one of them and be very aware of what the limiting cases are. For example, we did it in a constructive way, but we can go back. Like if you have GR, and if you assume that we are not really interested in the gravitational part of it, and you set the gravity to be weak, 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 you will end up getting special relativity. And in special relativity, if you say we are only interested in very low energy phenomena, you will get to classical mechanics. And in classical mechanics, if you switch on gravity without any relativistic effect thrown in, you will get Newtonian gravity. So you can go along all the paths, and these limiting things has to be structured properly. Most importantly, there must be a way to go from this plane to this plane. So I told you that this is the plane of classical physics, which we all love and understand, and it is pretty, in fact, I said it is almost trivial compared to the other plane. And this is the plane when the Planck's constant is switched on and it is fully quantum mechanical nature. So you want to go from this quantum mechanical theory to the classical theory, and we don't know how to do it. We have ideas, sketches and various cases, we know how to do it, but we really, really don't know how to do that. I'll explain to you in what sense, but this is not a lecture on quantum mechanics, so I won't go into it. But we can sort of work with it. We have enough tools to shut up and calculate, but we don't quite understand that limit in a proper way. The best way to understand that happens to be by what is known as the action, which I will introduce at some stage in the lectures. And that gives you this flow from here to here. But it is a good idea to first understand what is living here before we switch on this action, and then try to understand what goes from here to here. That is what I am going to do. I am going to start with this plane and try to describe things to you. So I have now used this word action several times. And as I said, some of you would know this, but as I promised, I am not going to assume you know it, and I am going to build from first principles. So what is action? Well, take any physical system you want to study, say electromagnetic field or gravitational field or just a ball you throw up and it is coming down, any physical system of your interest. All the information you ever need about that system can be obtained if somebody gives you something called the action, which describes that system. This action depends on what is known as the dynamical variables of the system. So there are dynamical variables for gravity, there are dynamical variables for electromagnetism, there are dynamical variables when you throw a ball up in the air. The action depends on how these dynamical variables evolve, the history of the dynamical variables in a particular way. And from that, you can describe both the quantum mechanical evolution of the system, and by taking appropriate limits, you can describe the classical behavior of the system. So most of the time, a theoretical physicist's job is to find out what is the action for different physical systems. And as systems get more and more complicated and experimental results are less and less available, then you have to play the intuitive game to figure out what that action is. But deeper than that, the action depends on the history of the dynamical variables of the system. So you need to know what are the dynamical variables of the system. You might think dynamical variables are easy. After all, we know how to describe a system, what are the dynamics. Actually, it is not. And there are bit of surprises there. And in fact, at some level, all the study of physics, all the study of trying to understand what the nature is made of, what space and time and matter is made of, is the same as the question of asking what are the true fundamental primitive dynamical variables of the nature. Okay, so it is a fairly deep question, but we will take again a physicist approach to the problem. That is, we will guess things, go along, and if things don't work out, we will do another guess. Okay, that is a very practical way and is a very successful way in physics. So, what are the dynamical variables? So, let us take a simplest case of a ball which you throw up. Okay, this is like particles having trajectories. Then you can describe the evolution of a dynamical variable by what is known as Newton's second law, which is this. So mass times, if I put a tilde at the bottom, it means it is a vectorial object. So this x is a vector. It has three components in three-dimensional space. We will stick with three-dimensional space. And if I put a dot, it is a time derivative. So if I put two dots, it is two time derivatives. So this is mass times acceleration, which is equal to force. Now of course, it's pretty much useless unless I tell you what the force is. So in classical physics, you want to deal with two forces. One force is the gravitational force, Fg, which is defined as minus m gradient of phi, where phi is the gravitational potential. Okay. Then we have another force in classical physics, which is the electromagnetic force, which is Q E plus V cross B. As I told you, the purpose of this lecture is rather conceptual and holistic. So I am not going to be too fussy about whether it is V or V by C or what are the units which I use, etc. All the essential factors I will include, but I am not going to bother about that. Those things you fix yourself or look it up in a textbook. So there are two forces here written, which is based on this. Of course, I could have also written as M times the gravitational field, which is usually given as G, and that G is minus gradient of a gravitational potential. Okay, and this is an electric field and this is the magnetic field. You should feel free to stop me at any time, I mean students, okay, and you ask any questions, and if the questions requires elaborate discussion, we will do it at the end of the lecture. But if it is some quick shot thing, something is not clear, or I make a goof up, just point it out then and there. Okay. So there are these two forces, and if somebody gives you E and B and G, I can put both these forces on the right hand side, and then I have a differential equation, and I know what is E, B and G at space and time, how it is varying. Then you plug it into a computer and you integrate and you find how the particle is moving. So the dynamical variable here is this quantity x of t. For my purpose, I will define dynamical variable to be something which obeys a differential equation which is second order in time. X obeys a differential equation which is second order in time. Now, of course, you can get smart and say that suppose I define x dot as another variable, then I can write two equations, both are first order in time. You can play such games. Or you can integrate x with respect to t, define some quantity and then take the derivative, etc. But most of the time, you will know what is the natural variable to use, and that variable will invariably turn out to satisfy a second order equation in time. There are other formulations in which you actually work with first order in all variables, but we don't need that. We will be able to manage everything with this. And that is a fairly good definition, even in electromagnetism, even in general relativity, and even in quantum field theory. So the genuine dynamical variables or obey equations which are ultimately second order in time. Fine. So I have the dynamical variable for the simplest case, of classical mechanics described here, where there are particles. But I wrote down here a G and E and B. So this system is not complete unless I tell you how G, E and B changes. Okay? So how does G change? That is easy. G satisfies an equation of this form. Curl of G is 0, which is trivial because it merely says that G is a gradient, and that is what we have already used. Then the divergence of G, which putting this gradient will give you a second equation. I might as well write down in terms of phi. Del square phi equals 4 pi capital G rho. So let me be a little bit more precise. This is del square phi t comma x equals 4 pi g rho t comma x. I will spend a moment on that. Now I don't know whether you are familiar with Newtonian law of gravitation written in this form, but I am assuming that you guys would have seen this as a Poisson equation in electrostatics, where the right hand side would have been minus rho by epsilon naught if you are an MKS guy, and that rho will be the charge density. The same idea applies for gravitational field, and the rho here is the mass density in Newtonian theory, and del square phi is equal to 4 pi g rho is your equation which determines g. What is rho? Rho is built out of the particles which is producing the gravitational field. If I tell you where the particles are at any given time, then you know what the density is. So once I know the particle positions on the left hand side, you can plug it back to find this rho and vice versa, right? There is something interesting about this equation. This tells you that if you change rho, that is suppose rho changes with time, the value of rho at any given time t determines the potential at that time. So if the sun just disappears, the source for Earth's gravity is just gone, it will take you 8 minutes to see that it has disappeared, because light takes 8 minutes to come from sun to Earth. But you will immediately feel the absence of the gravitational force and the Earth will shoot up in a tangent. Okay? So the gravity propagates instantaneously while light takes some time to propagate. You can already see signs of trouble with this, and there was trouble with it. Okay? But this is what Newton's law tells you. What about this E and B? Okay? That satisfies again four equations called Maxwell's equation. Actually two equations, but people like to think of it as four equations because two of those equations are trivial. It doesn't depend on what kind of sources you put. So one of those equations is divergence of B equals 0. The second equation is curl of E equals minus dB by dt. This equation does not care what kind of charge densities and currents and charges and currents in the lab you are keeping. Whatever you do, these two equations are true. The curl, I am assuming again that everybody knows vector analysis because you said you know Maxwell's equation. Maxwell's equations, it would be very difficult to teach you without using this vector analysis. So is there someone who is not familiar with these symbols? Okay, good. So the curl involves 1 by length, because this is a derivative with respect to space, and the way I am going to work with, there will be a V by C here so that E and B will have the same dimensions. In that case, this dt is a time derivative, this is a space derivative, so you need to take care of dimension. This equation is dimensionally wrong if what I have said is true. So you have to put an 1 by C d by dt. So instead of t, you need a ct. But I am going to use as much as possible C is equal to 1, the units. Now this is another place where people hesitate, because it is supposed to be very difficult for you to figure out how to work with a C is equal to 1 units, and you know it should be done slowly, etc. Nonsense. The point is that C is equal to 1 requires getting used to, and you have only 5 years to learn physics. So you should learn it on the first day, and then you have 5 years to get used to. Okay, it is true that you have to get used to. Any advanced concept which you need to get used to should be introduced early on. That seems to be logical, so that you have enough time to get used to. So all the lectures I will try to stick to C is equal to 1. Occasionally I will slip in C when it depends on it. Otherwise learn how to put C back into the equations. Okay, this is not rocket science. I mean, in fact, it is much more trivial than most of the physics you will be learning. So I will use these equations. Then the next pair of equations which you need are for divergence of E, that is either rho by epsilon naught or 4 pi rho depending on your units. I will just put rho. Okay, in the spirit of these lectures I won't worry about that. I will assume rho has been rescaled. Similarly, you have another equation which says curl of B is equal to dE by dt plus a current which I will call J. Again, there are factors here depending on units which we don't care. So these are the four equations which tells you how the electromagnetic field is going to change depending on what kind of charges are there. And when the electromagnetic fields change, they will exert a different force on the charged particles, and the charged particles will move through this. So this equation plus these four complete this system in the absence of gravity. This is all there is to classical physics, end of story. This plane is I need to get GR, but GR and SR, but to this non-relativistic classical physics is finished. Now it will turn out that this is not really non-relativistic classical physics, and these equations are not non-relativistic at all, they are actually relativistic, and that is how historically relativity was invented. Now we want to look at it a little bit more deeply. I told you that the dynamical variables are x of t for the particle which was sitting here. What are the dynamical variables for gravity, and what are the dynamical variables for electrodynamics? Okay. So let us take a look at it, because that is going to be useful. See, I don't want to talk about action. I told you that the action is a unifying concept in physics. We do not know of a single system in nature, single fundamental law of physics, which cannot be derived from an action principle. In fact, a few non-fundamental laws of physics can also be derived from action principle. So it is such a grand scheme of things that if you have electromagnetic field, there is an action principle for that. If there is a general relativity, there is a gravitational field, there is an action principle for that. So, and all of them has to be expressed in terms of the dynamical variable. So it's good to pause for a minute and look at what are the dynamical variables of this. In fact, the answer is very cute. I'm going to now study systems where there is no rho and no J. So I'm looking at free electromagnetic field. The free electromagnetic field, the position of a particle, the analogous thing in free electromagnetic field is the magnetic field. And the momentum of a particle, or the velocity of a particle, which I can get from this x by x dot, which would be the canonical pair with which you will be working. This is a second order differential equation, so you need to give two initial conditions. The natural initial conditions you will give is the value of x and value of x dot. So in the same spirit, the momentum or the canonically conjugate variable to the position in electromagnetism is the electric field. So the magnetic field is the position and the electric field is the momentum. Okay. Now just to give you a peep ahead, at least some of you would have heard that the energy density in the electromagnetic field is E square plus B square upon some 8 pi. If you haven't heard, don't worry about it, we will get to that. For those of you who know this, it is just P square plus Q square. And again, for those of you who know the action for electromagnetic field, which also we will derive, is E square minus B square. Okay? It is just P square minus Q square. The Lagrangian is just P square minus Q square. So if the energy is P square plus Q square and Lagrangian is P square minus Q square, This part everyone would know, this should ring a bell. This means it is a harmonic oscillator. So I will actually show you that the dynamical variables are actually those of a harmonic oscillator. How do we do that? Okay, let us start with these equations. And what I need to do is to first solve the two equations which are completely independent of position and, I mean, completely independent of the charge and the current. For that, let us start with B. Divergence of B is equal to 0 means B can be expressed as curl of a vector field, curl of a vector. So B is curl of A. Is there anyone who do not know this? Okay. Now what you do is that you go and plug this equation into the second equation. So we have taken care of this equation now by just taking this. Then you go and plug that thing here. Then what you will find is that you are going to have d by dt of curl of A. That is curl of dA by dt. There is a curl sitting on the left hand side. Bring them together. Curl of E plus dA by dt should be 0. If curl of something is 0, that something should be a gradient. Therefore, the two equations together tells you that not only B is like this, E is given by minus gradient of some quantity, which again we will call phi, is not the gravitational potential, the electrostatic potential, minus A dot. This is dA by dt. Okay, so this is taken care of. Now I want to go and solve these equations. It's pretty easy, but I want to introduce a trick, because that trick is going to be very useful, and the earlier you learn that trick, the better for you. The trick is that whenever you have operators like this curl, divergence, gradient, etc., it is nice to do things in the Fourier space. Well, not always. But when the equations are linear, and in this case equations are linear. What do I mean by that? If you, somebody has given you a rho 1 and j 1 and you have solved the Maxwell's equations, hence you have found the electric and magnetic fields. Next day somebody else gives you a rho 2 and j 2 and you have the corresponding electric and magnetic fields. Now if on the third day somebody gives you rho 1 plus rho 2 and j 1 plus j 2, then you don't have to solve it again. You just add the solutions E1 plus E2 and B1 plus B2. So these equations allow you to superpose solutions for different J's. And it's a very special property of these equations. Most systems in the world are nonlinear, but Maxwell's equations at the low energy limit are linear. So as a result of which, you find that you can superpose, and if you can superpose, things work good in the Fourier space. But as far as we are concerned, we are not going to deal with rho and j. I am going to look at the empty field, electromagnetic field. So I want to introduce the Fourier transform of these quantities. So what I will introduce, let us start with E. What is this E? E is a function of t, x. I want to write this in terms of its Fourier transform in space. So I am going to write this as integral t3k over 2 pi the whole cube. This is just a convention. E in Fourier space t comma k e to the I k dot x. Let us make sure you understand what we are doing. E has a vector sign here, which means there are three of them. There is Ex, Ey, Ez, or let me call it E1, E2, E3. There are three components to it. Take any one of the components, say E2. That E2 is a function of time and space. I leave the time alone. and I just Fourier transform it in space. So the x will get replaced by k, and that Fourier transform quantity is given here. This is also a vector, because for E1 I will get E1 here, E2 I will get E2, and E3 I will get E3. Now, normally I should have put some symbol here like a tilde or something to say that this function is different from this function. But in physics we misuse notation, and I will use the same symbol E. Because it depends on k and because this depends on x, you know that here it is in Fourier space and here it is in real space. In fact, it is very convenient in order to build your intuition for what is going to happen by actually changing the notation a little bit more and writing this as E subscript k t. So the idea is that for every value of k, there is something which just depends on time. We are ultimately on things which depend only on time, like x of t, because they can be identified with dynamical variables. So we are moving towards that. But of course, for every k, there is a t, so there are large number of k's, in fact, infinite number of k's. So that is the best we have done so far. Yeah. This notation. This is just a way of writing the quantity E of t comma k. Instead of putting the k inside, because it is a Fourier transformed variable and E is a function of k, I am just saying that E is a function of k. What does it mean to say E is a function of k? For every value of k, I know what E is at a given time t. So I just put that k there to indicate that. Okay? You will see where it helps the intuition in a minute. Not in a minute, in probably in 10 minutes. Okay, so you have this. Now I can play the same game with everything else. I can do it for B, I can do it for A, I can do it for phi. Alright? So I have a whole lot of things sitting in the Fourier space. Why am I doing this? The reason I am doing this is that if I have an operator, say curl or divergence, anything to do with this object, acts on something like E. Imagine that there is E here. It could have been divergence of E. Okay, this operation is irrelevant. So some operation with this L is acting on this. So if I take curl and I act on E, the curl involves derivatives with respect to spatial coordinates. So they don't care about these. They don't care about this, no spatial coordinates. So it just acts on e to the ikx. What will it do? Every time you differentiate with respect to d by dx, it is going to bring down an I times kx. Right? Therefore, if you do the curl operation on the real space quantity, so I'll just call it RS, real space, this is equivalent to taking I k cross in the Fourier space. This is an extremely useful trick. It is valid all the time and it works in any number of dimensions, in any number of Fourier transforms. Okay? So it's good to learn it as quickly as possible. So the rule is that if you are working on this side and you see a curl, go to Fourier space and I put this I k cross of the Fourier transformed variable. If this was a dot, you take ik dot. If it was just a gradient, you just put ik. Okay? This is the rule we want to follow. So if you do that, what will I get? Let us see. So we already have these equations, and then we want to know what these two equations reduces to. To do this most efficiently, we are going to do one more simplification. I am going to think of a situation where phi is 0, the electrostatic potential is 0, and the A satisfies the condition divergence of A equals 0. That is, I am claiming that this B and E, when there is no rho and J, can always be chosen to be obtained from a phi and a A which satisfies this condition. So that this actually goes away. Okay. How do I know that? Well, there are very formal ways of doing it, which involve something called gauge transformation. That is a very beautiful topic by itself, but I am not going to introduce it at the very first lecture. We will probably do it at a much later stage. Okay. By which you can show that if you have E and B, that does not uniquely fix A and phi, and you can change them and you can reduce to this condition whichever way you like. But there is a much nicer and cheaper way of doing it. Let us assume this is true and see what happens. If it cannot be taken, equations will tell you some nonsense will result, 2 equals 3 or something like that, then we will go back. Okay? You will find that nothing happens and it works out. So that answer is good. And this kind of a procedure works in physics most of the time, so you shouldn't be afraid of doing it. So let us try this answer, but as I said, in this particular case it can be proved very rigorously that this can be chosen. So I have done this. Now I go back to this equation and that equation, because with rho equals 0 and J equals 0. So you want divergence of E equals 0. What is divergence of E? Divergence of E is minus, this is a time derivative of divergence of A. But divergence of A is set to 0. So divergence of E is automatically satisfied to be 0, and not only that, its time derivative also vanishes. That actually is a slightly advanced comment, but that is important because you can impose this condition. When the system evolves, will it preserve those conditions? Because its time derivative also vanishes, if it is vanishing at this point and its time derivative doesn't is also 0, it will not change at the next time step, etc, etc, etc. So it will remain 0. So that is taken care of, we don't need to worry about it. This is also taken care of. So the only equation we need is this with J is equal to 0. So let us see what it gives. So we want curl of B, that is I K cross. That is for curl, and then I have to write B. What is B? B is curl of A, this is I k cross in Fourier space A subscript k. It depends on t, but I haven't written it down. This is the left hand side. On the right hand side I have d by dt of E in Fourier space, so that is minus AK double dot. Okay. Now what does this equation mean? Okay. First I into I gives me a minus sign which goes away with it. Well, the problem with rubbing all these is in the end I will get an equation with a sign wrong and we have to go back and figure out where it happened, but let us hope it works. So I have taken these two off. So I have a k cross ak. This is a triple product. So that is k into k dot ak. What is k dot ak? We said divergence of A is equal to 0, which in Fourier space is I k dot ak equals 0. So k dot ak term does not contribute. The second term is k into k dot ak gone, then minus ak into I have k square. Okay. So I get this equation to, I reduce this equation to, probably will need a little bit more space. Oops. Minus k square AK. Of course, AK is also vectors. So I should have put a vector symbol here, a vector symbol here, vector symbol here. Okay. Minus K square AK equals AK double dot. So let us write it down with all the terms in one side. It tells you that AK double dot plus K square AK is equal to 0. That's it. End of the road. Okay. Now let us go through this, because I know that this algebra was a bit dense for some of you. So I'll just review it once again. What we started with was these four equations, Maxwell's equations. Two of them did not involve current and charges, so I first decided to take care of them. We took care of them by this equation with this condition. B is curl of A comes from this. You plug it into this, move it to this side. Curl of something has to be 0, which means that something has to be a gradient. That something is just E plus this A dot. So we put a gradient of phi here, or let me write it down for a moment. Okay. Then the only step, which I did not prove to you rigorously, but I showed implicitly by solving the equation that it works, is that you can use this, you can impose this condition on these quantities. We'll come back to that much later, I promise you. So you have put that condition here and you have said divergence of is equal to 0. Then I have to solve these two equations. For that I introduced a trick. I said that instead of working in real space, let us work in Fourier space. Anything in sight, we will Fourier transform by putting a e to the I k dot x. So the electric field at time t at a point x is given as some variable in Fourier space, which depends on k and t, times e to the I k dot x integrated over. And similarly for vector potential A, similarly for phi, similarly for B, etc., etc. The advantage of this is that once you do that, operators like curl, divergence, etc. becomes very simple, and they become just cross products and dot products in K space. Any operation with del in real space is equivalent to the same operation with the vector ik in Fourier space. Okay? So we did that. So we found that this operation in real space is equivalent to k dot ak in the Fourier space. We will have to come back to this. This is an important equation. Then all that was, then this was trivially satisfied. All that was left was just one single equation with j equals 0. Free electromagnetic field is what we are looking at. So if you take that equation, you find that the curl of B has a k cross coming from the curl. This becomes k cross. Then B has a curl of A that gives you another k cross, ak. On the right hand side, I had dA by dt, which becomes A double dot. Then we just work this out. So differential equations become algebraic equations. So this is the rule of the middle term, k into k dot ak minus k square ak, k dot ak goes away, so you get minus k square ak. We move it to that side and you get this. Now this equation all of you should know. You probably never thought Maxwell's equations are this. This is a harmonic oscillator equation for ak. Some quantity, forget this vector symbol, take any one of the components a1, and forget the k, because you just choose any k you like. For a given k, for a given component, it says double derivative of something plus a constant times that quantity is equal to 0. And the frequency of that oscillator depends on k. Once again, k has the dimensions of 1 by length. This has dimensions of 1 by length square. This has dimensions of 1 by time square. So you need an 1 by c square here. Okay, so to be precise, I should have written this, or I could have taken that c square with this k square, and I could have put c square k square here. Actually, it is nicer to put the c here in this particular case, but we will come back to later. Either one of them is fine. So what does it mean? What have we achieved? Actually, we have achieved quite a bit. We have now shown that the dynamical variables for electromagnetic field are just ak of t. For every value of k, you have a variable ak which depends just on time. And this dynamical variable is also a well-known dynamical variable. It satisfies a harmonic oscillator equation. So electromagnetic field is nothing but a whole bunch of harmonic oscillator. Quite a lot of them, in the sense that actually there are infinite number of them, but that is not a frightful thing, because these harmonic oscillators are not talking to each other. So if you understand one harmonic oscillator, you understand infinite number of them. Okay, so that is not an issue. So the entire free electromagnetic field has been solved for you. It is just a bunch of harmonic oscillators, and the frequency of this oscillator is just k square c square. Okay, for each one of them. So the dynamical variable here turns out to be just ak. But I told you dynamical variable is magnetic field. So what is going on? Okay, for that you have to look at it a little bit more carefully. What does this condition mean? Suppose you go to the k space. So you have, this is kx, ky, and kz. So this is some space in which the k vectors live. So take any one point, there is a vector k connecting to that. Then take a plane which is orthogonal to that k. Because this k dot ak is 0, ak lives in that plane, because ak should be orthogonal to k. So k is in this direction, so you put a visiting card there, and ak is going to live in that plane. So ak has only 2 degrees of freedom, right? For every value of k, you can put a basis like this. This is k piercing through the visiting card, and 2 coordinates on the visiting card, and you can resolve the ak into 2 components on that. So ak has only 2 degrees of freedom. So the electromagnetic field genuinely for every value of k has only 2 degrees of freedom, and this corresponds to the 2 polarizations of electromagnetic field. But what is important is that because of this condition, there is an on-to-on correspondence between magnetic field and this vector potential. Because what is magnetic field? Magnetic field is curl of A, which was ik cross ak. So I have a vector k and a vector ak, and I am taking cross product. But this vector k and vector ak are already perpendicular. So if 2 vectors are perpendicular and you take the cross product, the magnitude is just an ordinary product. It only rotates it by 90 degrees, right? So the magnitude or all the dynamical features of bk are already incorporated in ak. So you take this k cross and bk is the same as ak. There is a one-to-one correspondence between them. Because bk satisfies divergence of b is equal to 0, which is same as k dot bk is equal to 0, b also lives in this plane. So A lives in this visiting card, B also lives in this visiting card, and when you take K cross, it only rotates it by 90 degrees. So there are 2 degrees of field, degrees of freedom of the magnetic field, which has one-to-one correspondence with the 2 degrees of freedom of AK, so you can trade one for the other. Hence, the dynamical degrees of freedom in the electromagnetic case, which, where are Maxwell's equations? Here. The dynamical degrees of freedom in this particular case can be taken to be bk of t, because this is essentially ak of t, but they have a one-to-one correspondence. What about the equivalent of x dot? Well, x dot should be like ak dot, because ak is the dynamical variable, ak dot is the conjugate quantity, like the position and velocity of an oscillator. What is ak dot? Ak dot is nothing but E. That is easy. So the momentum variable is Ek of t. These are the dynamical variables from which you have to build the action for the electromagnetic field. I haven't even told you how to build actions, but when you eventually do that, just as in the case of a particle, the dynamical variable is x of t, the dynamical variable in the case of electromagnetic field is B and E, or equivalently Ak and Ak dot. Okay? Fine. So if you are up for something more, what are the dynamical degrees of freedom of the gravitational field? We had gravitational field as well in the list somewhere, right? It satisfies this equation. Newtonian gravity, like Newtonian, like the classical electrodynamic. Yeah.
Can you just repeat the part 1
of AK and AK? This is why AK and, sorry, I didn't get your question. What do I want me to repeat? A and B. Okay. So let us take this equation which we imposed, which tells you that divergence of A is equal to 0. We anyway know from Maxwell's equations that divergence of B is equal to 0. Translate both of them into K space, Fourier space. Then this equation become K dot AK equals 0. This equation would have become K dot BK equals 0. Now you look at the K space. So what does the K space look like? There is a Kx, Ky, Kz. There is a K vector. Now at any given point, which is where that K vector is sitting, both A and B, AK and BK, has to be perpendicular to this. So you take a perpendicular plane there. That is what I said. You take this arrow and hit it with a visiting card and let it pierce through. That visiting card is a two-dimensional plane. Your AK and BK has to live in it. Right? So I can decompose them into two unit vectors on that visiting card. Let's call it alpha and beta. There is one vector in this direction, one vector in this direction. So I can decompose them. So there is a A1 and A2 for a given K. Similarly, there is a B1 and B2. So component wise, we are fine. Now the next thing which we know is that the B and A are related by this relation, K cross AK, right? Now this K cross AK, the cross doesn't mean anything, because we already know that A and K are perpendicular to each other. So if I take a K vector here, and suppose your A vector was like this. Okay, let me draw this. This is this visiting card, okay? I'm just taking that visiting card and putting it here. So there are two axes here. And let us say the magnetic field was like this, or A was like this, and the K is pointing in this direction. So what is K cross AK? You use your rule and you will have B here. What is the magnitude of B? Magnitude of B is just K times AK. So both the direction and magnitude of B is fixed entirely in terms of A and vice versa. Okay? That is the argument. So what are the degrees of freedom of the gravitational field? I mean, we did this for the electromagnetic field in great glory. So what do we do for magnetic field? We can't do anything. Gravitational field do not have a dynamical degree of freedom in Newtonian theory. This might sound surprising, but it is true. Newtonian gravitational field does not have dynamical degrees of freedom associated with them. Obviously something is wrong. Yes, it was wrong, and that is why we needed GR. Okay? The reason it is so is very easy. Take this equation, play the same game. This is a linear equation in rho. Newtonian gravitational field is also linear, just like electromagnetic field. Go to Fourier space. What will happen? Del square will become minus K square. Why minus? Because one gradient will be ik, another divergence of that gradient will be another I. The I into I gives you the minus. K square phi k of t, this is the left hand side, that is equal to, even with matter, 4 pi g Rho K of T. So if I tell you the source, the positions of all the particles, I know what is rho of xt, I can take its Fourier transform and find what this is. If I just divide it by minus k square, I know what is phi k of t. There is nothing, no independent degree of freedom there, unlike in electromagnetic case. It is related to the fact that the phi at any given time t is related to the rho at the same time t. So they also have an one-to-one correspondence, and there is nothing extra which is happening. While this equation tells you, this is an oscillator equation, which means at any given, for any given k, it is oscillating up and down with a frequency which is equal to ck. And its spatial variation is always given by e to the I k dot x. So you already get a k dot x and a minus or plus I omega t. Kx minus I omega t is a wave propagation. So there are electromagnetic wave solutions to electromagnetic case. There are no wave solution to this. It's completely frozen. Once you give the rho k, phi k is frozen. So you do not have, which makes stands to reason. I told you that if sun disappears, we will know that the gravitational field of the sun has disappeared immediately. So there is no propagation at the speed of light. This is why I said that probably it is more insightful to write it like this. If you write it like this and you take c going to infinity limit, this term goes away. And you just k square ak. If there were source term, that would sit on the right hand side. It would look very much like this. So when c goes to infinity, electrodynamics will also look like gravity, so to speak. The propagation will be instantaneous, or rather the propagation will be always at the speed of light, and if c is equal to infinity, it propagates with infinite speed. So that is exactly what happens in gravity. Rather than saying that it is instantaneous, you can say that it propagates with infinite speed. Okay? So in Newtonian theory, there are no quantities which you can build from phi which satisfies a second order differential equation in time, unlike in electromagnetism. So this is the main difference between these two, and we have already done this and we have talked about this quantity. Fine. Now let us go a bit further. What we want to do this is that you have these things. What happens when you introduce GR and what happens when you introduce SR? These are the two things we want to take that further. Because even though I did electrodynamics, I didn't mention anything about SR. Now it turns out that historically there were two revolutions, so to speak, which happened at the early part of 1900. One is the revolution which led to relativity, special theory of relativity, and another is the revolution which led to quantum theory. Now usually people dub these two things together and say that there were two revolutions and classical physics was overthrown, etc. But these revolutions are very different in character. Now, when the relativistic revolution take place, both special relativity and general relativity, even though conceptually there were all these things of space and time merging together and space-time becoming curved, and it all sounds fantastic, nice, good science fiction, mathematically, the structural aspects of the equation didn't change. If you have been writing a computer program to solve equations of motion in classical physics, you could have used your skill set to handle special relativity and general relativity without any problem. But conceptually, things changed much more drastically when quantum mechanics came in. I will try to illustrate it in the next lecture. So as a result of which, what happened with special relativity and general relativity is actually very easy to explain as far as the concepts go. So what happened in special relativity is best introduced by going back to this equation. This equation tells you that there is an invariance on the left hand side. So what do I mean by an invariance? Suppose you have two coordinate systems. I have one coordinate system. This is x, this is y, and I have another coordinate system which I will call x bar and y bar. And the second coordinate system is moving with respect to the first one with some velocity, capital V, in this direction. Okay? Now, you take some point here and you look at the distances as measured in both the cases. Okay? So, you can easily see that in the x bar coordinates, this is the distance, and in the x coordinate, this is the distance. Right? This is my original coordinate and this is the bar coordinate. So, you find that x bar coordinate distance, x bar, is given by x minus capital Vt. Why? Because this distance is what it has traveled in a time t. Let us assume that they were together at t is equal to 0, and everything is being looked at given time t, and we implicitly assume that t bar is equal to t. So let me write that also down here. T bar is equal to t. So let us ask where this comes from. And the standard answer in classical physics is it comes from common sense. The common sense tells you that t bar should be equal to t, and whether just because you move, time should not change. And common sense also tells you that you use the geometry that there is this much of distance which is built from this distance plus this distance. Okay? So as a result of which we have these two equations. Now this equation is even true if it moves along some other direction. So I can put a vector symbol here. Now, of course, we all know that common sense is wrong and these equations are wrong. But it is interesting to ask what remained invariant when we went from classical mechanics to special relativity. These equations tell you something interesting. Suppose you take x double dot of this. So, if you take x dot, you will find there is a velocity v measured in one frame. Let me write this here. Just take one time derivative of this equation. Because t bar is equal to t, it doesn't matter how you are doing it, which frame you are doing it. So if you take one time derivative, you will get a velocity in one frame equal to velocity in the other frame minus capital V. Now you take one more time derivative. That will give you the acceleration. The acceleration in the first frame is equal to the acceleration in the other frame, and derivative of capital V, but V is constant, so it is 0. Because your equations of motion involved acceleration, I mean, I could have written down an Aristotelian equation of motion. Aristotle used to believe that you need force to keep a body moving with constant velocity. Again, common sense. You roll a ball on the ground and after some time the ball comes to rest. So if you don't constantly push it, things comes to rest. So you need a force to keep them moving. So he thought that the velocity is what is produced by the force. So one would have written down an Aristotelian law by saying that mx dot is equal to force. If you have done that, if you make this transformation, the left hand side will not be the same. Now the left hand side is invariant. So this invariance goes under the name Galilean relativity or Galilean relativistic invariance. What it tells you roughly that as long as the right hand side F transforms in a sensible way, which we will come back to, then you cannot figure out whether you are moving with a uniform velocity or whether you are staying at rest by performing experiments inside a cabin. Like if you have a car which is moving with a uniform velocity and you have a friend who is standing at rest next to it, you perform some experiment, he performs some experiment, you cannot detect this uniform velocity motion without looking outside. Okay? That is because the laws of physics involve essentially second order derivatives in time, and the transformation involves only a linear function of time in uniform velocity motion. So this statement then you cannot figure out whether you are moving with a uniform velocity, that is whether you are in this frame or that frame, by performing experiment. Turns out to be true. But these equations are not true. These equations get modified. These equations get modified in special relativity, and the most important consequences of that modification is this is wrong. This gets modified, it gets modified by a gamma factor, but that is not really important. What is really important is that T bar is not equal to T. So what does it mean physically? What it means physically is the following. Let us now draw a diagram which is not a spatial diagram but a space-time diagram. So this is sort of a surrealistic representation of all the three axes in one line. So if you want to, you just think of one axis, and this is time T. More precisely, it should have been CT, but remember C is 1, so the dimensions are fine. Now you take a clock and put it on some trajectory like this. Okay, it is moving in some orbit. It is not moving uniformly, it is moving in some arbitrary trajectory. Now let us say it was here at some time and it went here at some other time, and there was an interval dt here. So at some time t, the clock was here, so it's a clock. Okay, and at some other time t plus delta t, it was here. It went along some trajectory and it has traveled a distance dx. Now the clock phase had some reading here and some reading here, and we want to know what is the difference in these two readings. It turns out that the reading in the clock, that is the clock time interval, the time interval as measured by the clock, which I will call d tau square, happens to be dt square minus the distance traveled dx square by c square. Okay, so let us just digest that. So there is a clock which is moving around and came back. So we know what is the total distance it has traveled. You, for an infinitesimal segment of that, you take that distance dx. And you ask, so to speak, how long would have light taken to travel that distance? That would be dx upon c. You subtract it from what your clock was showing. You are sitting here with a clock, looking at the other clock which is moving. Okay? The stationary clock measures dt. The moving clocks measure d tau. This is the moving clock. This is the stationary clock. And they differ by this. Obviously, there is a minus sign, which means that if this was like 10 minutes, this would have been 8 minutes. So the moving clock shows a slower lapse of time, smaller lapse of time, it slows down. Yeah. It doesn't have to. If there is some way of you reading what the phase of the clock is here and there, by any form of signals, that is good enough. Okay? So I mean, this coming back to etc. are introduced because people want to solve things like twin paradox and all that. The twin paradox in turn comes because people think that this has something to do with the Lorentz transformation. Now, this is not a lecture on relativity. You can either watch my previous series which was given here, or better still, read up Landau Classical Theory of Fields. He will point out that this has absolutely nothing to do with the Lorentz transformation, and in fact, you derive Lorentz transformation from it. And that also creates the myth that there is something called length contraction and there is something called time dilation, and they are both of similar thing, nothing of that kind. Time dilation is a real effect, it stays even after the particle has come back. Length contraction is a fictitious effect. I mean, it is real for some purposes, but it is not at equal standing. But I don't have time to go into that. So this is the first thing which we want. We, special relativity's main modification is that motion affects the flow of time as measured by clocks. The clock rates are affected by motion. So we have got that. That is what comes in here. Now, corresponding to that, these equations also get transformed. It gets into some Lorentz transformation. And now we want all our equations to be invariant under the new transformation. Now, obviously, this equation is not invariant, so you have to change that. That is what introduces relativistic concept of momentum, etc., etc. But what about Maxwell's equations? It turns out that Maxwell's equations are actually invariant under this transformation. And in fact, it is rather nice to think of it in another way. We used to think that these are the correct equations. Now you can go and ask, if these are the correct equations and you go from this frame to this frame, what happens to Maxwell's equation? Do they remain the same? Okay, it's a bit of a calculation because you don't know how E and B are going to change, but you can show, as I said, it's a complicated thing, but some of you should try it out. You can show that however, whichever way you transform E and B, there is no way Maxwell's equations will transform to itself if the transformations of the coordinates are x bar equals x minus vt and t bar equals t. What does it mean? Fantastic. That means using Maxwell's equations and electromagnetic phenomena, we can figure out whether we are in a moving car or not. This is what two gentlemen, Michelson and Morley, tried to do. Not exactly like this, but broadly. Broadly, that was the idea. And they couldn't. So that showed a lot of contradictions. And one of the, now we already see that Maxwell's equations are not going to be invariant under this transformation. And another gentleman called Lorentz figured out what is the transformation under which Maxwell's equations are going to be invariant. And these are the transformations named after him, called the Lorentz transformation. Now the question is, we have two sets of transformation. We have this Galilean transformations and we have Lorentz transformation. Electromagnetism is invariant under Lorentz transformation and mechanics is invariant under Galilean transformation. So people said, so be it. I mean, we will use mechanics this transformation and electrodynamics this transformation. That, as you can imagine, runs into trouble. Because there are particles which are moving, they are producing electromagnetic fields. These electromagnetic fields are acting back on them. So you cannot sort of say that on one side when the particles are moving, I will use one set of transformation, and another side when the electromagnetic waves are propagating and affecting the particles, I will use another set of transformation. So it gets into a holy mess, and that mess was solved by Einstein by saying, no, everywhere you should use Lorentz transformation. It is the Newton's laws of motion which we need to change. Maxwell's equations come out unscathed because they were already relativistically invariant. They are consistent with special relativity. That is why I said that it is easiest to introduce Maxwell's equation through special relativity because the structure is very beautiful. So you don't have to do anything there. But what about gravity? Now, gravity obviously runs into trouble because we already said that in gravity things travel with instantaneous, with infinite speed, and that you cannot have. So what you need to do is to modify that gravitational law in a particular way and then obtain a new description which is consistent with special relativity. That is, we had Newtonian gravity here, and once special relativity came, we had to make these two consistent, and that is what led to GR. Now what we need out of GR is extremely minimal, because I'm going to get into action and action principle, etc., in the next lecture. What we need for that is very simple result. So I will state the result today, I won't derive it, and I will derive it for you in the next lecture, and then we will get on with it. What it tells you is that in when gravity is present, this relation changes. This relation tells you that if a clock is moving and another clock is stationary, the moving clock slows down. So if I have a clock on the table and a clock on the ground, they will show the same rate because they are not moving with respect to each other. General relativity tells you that this is not true because these clocks are in gravitational field. If a clock is kept at a stronger gravitational field, it will run slower. Okay? Now this might sound a bit surprising to you, but it is absolutely trivial to derive. It will probably take me 5 minutes in the next lecture to derive it for you, to convince you that this is true. Okay, this is, like all great principles, this is very easy. Once you have got that, rest of general relativity is a matter of technique, matter of mathematical technique. It took long time for Einstein because the mathematics was not well developed at that time, etc. But or rather it was well developed, but physicists didn't know that. But once you this is the basic physics point in GM. What is the mathematical statement of that? If the gravitational field is weak, the statement is very simple. It says that this equation theta square I have written, let me write it for a quantity c square theta square, that is I am multiplying everything by c square. Then this equation would have been c square dt square minus dx square. What general relativity said is that you change it into 1 plus 2 phi by c square, c square dt square minus dx square. So if there is no gravitational potential, this phi goes to 0, this is 1 and it is c square dt square minus dx square, you get back this. If there is a gravitational potential, you just multiply the term involving dt square by a factor 1 plus 2 phi by c square, why phi is the weak gravitational potential. Now if you remember your expression for escape velocity, you will know that phi gravitational potential has dimensions of square of the velocity, gm by r and things like that. So 2 phi by c square is a dimensionless quantity, that is why we are adding it to 1. So I haven't fudged any c factors or anything here. And you should go and compute phi by c square for things like earth, sun, etc., or a galaxy, etc. You will find that it is pretty small. Okay, so this weak gravitational field has a very wide domain of applicability. Now what has this to do with clock rates? That is very easy. Suppose a clock is not moving. I have one clock on the top of the table, one clock at the bottom. So dx is 0 for both the clocks. I want to know what is theta. When dx is equal to 0 and your reference clock measures the time dt, the clock rate of the tabletop clock will depend on phi on the tabletop. The clock rate of the table bottom clock will depend on the phi at the bottom of the table. So if you take the ratio, it is 1 plus 2 phi 1 by c square divided by 1 plus 2 phi 2 upon c square. So if you know the gravitational potential on the top of the table and gravitational potential at the bottom, you know how much it changes. The deeper the gravitational potential, the slower the clock will move. Okay? So this modification I will derive for you in the next lecture, and then we will move on to the other side of the plane, the QM. Okay? So let us, if nobody else is using this room, we will probably have this figure there. Okay? If somebody is cleaning it up, leave the figure. So we will go to this QM part of it. And everything which I have said here is not just to teach you electrodynamics and gravity after starting on a lecture on action. We will use each and every one of them. Okay? So we will do that. So let me take questions for a few minutes, and we will also have a session. This we found it to be useful last time. I'll spend some 5 minutes in the beginning of the second lecture asking you for questions on this lecture. So anything which is not clear, talk among yourselves, and it is still not clear, you come back tomorrow and let me know the question. So one standard question, is the pace okay? Do I have to slow down or speed up? Who thinks I should slow down? How many? Put up your hands. This is not good. Okay, we will see how long it survives. Okay, I'll ask you, one, and there was one more hand. Okay. And fine, all right, that is still not good. Okay, so we'll see what happens after tomorrow. You let me know whether I have to slow down. Okay, probably this some of the material was familiar, but this material evaporate from the head if you don't look through it tonight or tomorrow morning. Believe me, it evaporates. Okay, so just check through whatever you have learned. Yeah, questions? Yeah. Yes.
So how big should it be?
5 by C square should be small enough. So if your experimental accuracy is epsilon, 5 by C square should be less than epsilon. So you tell me what accuracy you need. Okay? So suppose you want an accuracy of 1 part in 10,000. Then 5 by C square should be at least 1 part in 10,000.
Fields travel at the speed of light.
Fields travel at a speed of light. Yes, I think sensible fields will travel at speed of light.
Why does gravity doesn't?
Oh, gravity does. Newtonian gravity doesn't, because Mr. Newton got it wrong. Okay. So tomorrow I will tell you what the general relativity does. In general relativity, it travels at the speed of light.
Deriving the equation,
we put
the assumption
pi
equal to 0
delta d equal to 0. That's correct.
Now, how do we justify that assumption?
Yeah, okay. So, that, as I said, if everything works according to plan, somewhere towards 4th lecture or 3rd lecture end, I will derive for you electromagnetism from scratch. Okay? So, at that time, it will become very clear to you that you can do that. Okay? But a quick answer to this is the following. Suppose you start with a and phi, okay, and then you add to a gradient of some function, and add to phi the time derivative of the same function, or rather subtract from phi this time derivative of this function. Then you can easily show, it's trivial to show that E and B does not change. Okay, so A and phi are not unique. I mean, take B is equal to curl of A. That doesn't tell you what A is, because if I add to A gradient of some function, curl of that gradient will go away. Therefore, just knowing the magnetic field, I can't fix the A. I have a freedom in that. I can use that freedom to set 1 degree out of the 3 degrees of freedom to a value I want, namely to 0. That is how you get this divergence of A. Divergence of A is one condition on 3 component of the vectors. Okay? And similarly, you can put phi is equal to 0. But that is not a rigorous proof. There is a very rigorous way of starting from this, making this transformation, and showing that these differential equations have sensible solutions. That you can always do that. I mean, which you do in vector analysis method in electrodynamics, but there is a much cuter way of getting to it, which I will try to show on 4th lecture. Yeah. But I gave you another argument, which is not a joke. You assume that, plug it in, and if you can solve Maxwell's equation sensibly, most of the time you are right. Okay, the problem is with this most of the time, but it works in this particular case. Okay, if you make some other assumption, like for example, if you try to put A is equal to 0 and phi is equal to something, you will find that the equations cannot be satisfied. How is phi related to the Gaussian curvature of? No, I am not getting the question. I am not hearing it properly. Gaussian curvature of what?
Space-time geometry.
Oh, of the space-time geometry. So you know how to compute a curvature tensor for a given metric?
No.
No. Okay. So the idea is that there is a particular formula which tells you what is the curvature of any space-time given what is known as the metric. What I have essentially given you is the metric, and using that formula you can compute it. There is nothing simple or special for the Gaussian curvature in terms of phi. You get a result which involves the second derivatives of phi. Okay, yeah.
I have a small off-topic question.
Yeah.
So when we are writing the Fourier transformation, like E of t from x goes to in the Fourier.
Correct.
So when we are taking the curl of this, what do we mean by taking the curl of e raised to iota x? Because basically that is a wave with momentum k.
Oh, no, you don't take curl of that. Sorry, I should have probably amplified that. So let us first think of gradient before we get to curl. Suppose I have a scalar function phi and you rotate in the Fourier space. Okay, so let me just do that, because that is probably the only tricky thing I introduced today. If I can find a chalk, yeah. So suppose I have a scalar function Suppose I have a scalar function phi, which is phi of t comma x, which I am writing as a integral over this dk and d3k and all that, okay, 2 pi the whole cubed, etc. Don't worry about those factors. There is a phi k of t e to the I k dot x. In this particular case, suppose I am taking a gradient, what will it be? So I have integral and I have d3k, I have phi k, and I have to evaluate the gradient of that, right? Are you convinced that that is okay? Because what we are doing is that in order to compute the gradient, I have to take d by dx. So let us just take one component of this gradient. Suppose the x component of this gradient, that will be d phi by dx. So if I differentiate this with respect to x, what I am going to get is I k x. Yes, go on.
Yeah, how I see the integral is, it's basically the linear combination of all the grids and they are scaled with phi of k.
That's correct. Right. That's absolutely correct.
Now, what do we mean by taking the curl of a wave? Because like we are taking the
No, we are not taking the curl of a wave or any such thing. What we are doing is that I have a function e to the I k dot x. Right?
A wave, right? Like we can interpret it as a wave with
Yes, but don't, okay, because this wave is only in space and not in space and time, because that we haven't yet figured out, that is hiding inside this. This is just e to the ikx, so it is just a sinusoidal variation in space. If it sinusoidally varies in space and time, then you get a wave, otherwise you have to think of in terms of some other complicated object, but this is just sine and cosine. Now the derivative, the gradient operator acting on it is just an ordinary differentiation. Of course it gets a bit tricky if I want to take curl, because if I am going to take curl, I have to take dx of ay minus dy of ax. So I will get kx with a ay multiplying minus ky into ax multiplying.
So what does this mean geometrically? If you are doing the mathematics, that's why I see.
Correct. So you have no issues with the mathematics. So what are you asking geometrically?
How shall I see this this action of this nabla operator?
How do you see the action of the nabla operator in real space on A? No. Let us take the action of nabla operator on just A, curl of A, in the real space. How do you see it?
So basically, I see A as either it will be a scalar field or a vector field.
Let us take a vector field and compute, let us look at curl of A.
Yes, so yeah. Basically this is telling me the measure of the curl of the vector field.
But what is curl of a vector field? You see, curl as a differential object do not have, as far as I know, simple geometrical interpretation. But if you take the line integral of A around it, then the curl has a natural interpretation, okay? Unfortunately, we need local derivative operators. So I can come up with cooked up interpretations that if you take e to the I k dot x as a function, then if you take the gradient, it tells you where it is going up and where it is coming down, etc. But that doesn't give you anything, any great insight. So it is more natural to think of the degrees of freedom as living entirely in k-space. Forget the real space completely. And in fact, when you go to quantum field theory and all that, this k will acquire great level of reality. And you know, for example, the quanta of the field, k will be the momentum of the quanta of the field. You don't even have to do quantum field theory. Condensed matter is full of various magnons, rotons, phonons, various onons. And you take any one of them, and you will have exactly the same kind of behavior. They look nicer and better in Fourier space than in real space. That is what I am trying to channelize your thought into.
Yeah, but
okay. to, I can't think of a simpler geometrical interpretation for gradient or curl acting on these objects in the Fourier space. Yeah. Okay, yeah.
So for electromagnetic field, you have defined the dynamical variables, you comparing it with harmonic oscillator equation.
That's right.
So can we say something about the energy density of this field?
Sure. Sure. What is the energy density of the field? Let us think about it. So the energy, the suppose I have a harmonic oscillator which is q double dot plus omega square q square. So the energy density will be q dot square plus omega square q square, except half factors and all that, right? What is q dot square? Q dot square here is e square, right? And omega square a square conveniently comes with a k square. Omega is kc. So it is k square a square. K square A square is just B square. So the energy density is EK square plus VK square.
So we can say also with Hamiltonian energy.
Absolutely, the Hamiltonian is EK square plus VK square. Right? And Lagrangian will be with a minus sign. Okay? So if you think in terms of harmonic, the best way to think about free harmonic oscillator and even harmonic oscillator interacting, I mean, best way to think about free electromagnetic field, even electromagnetic field interacting with matter, is as a bunch of harmonic oscillators. You will never get it wrong.
Sir, if it's an electromagnetic field in matter, will these harmonic oscillators still be not interacting with each other?
That is a bit non-trivial. There are two ways of thinking about it. One way to think about this is that you have electromagnetic field hitting matter and there are things which are jiggling and they produce more electromagnetic field, and you think of it as two separate processes. In that language, they don't interact with each other. Another way is to say that in the presence of matter, I am going to, the technical term is integrate out the matter. So I just have a wave hitting somewhere and I want to know how the wave is coming out. And the matter is, for me, is a black box. Then you want to think of it as some kind of an effective interaction. Now it turns out that for very nice homogeneous, you don't start with a calcite crystal, but if it is a nice homogeneous object without any optical activity, etc., there is only one function which is needed to describe this. This is called a refractive index. And that refractive index depends on the frequency of the radiation. So with just that thing, with that k square, c square being modified, that is why you say that the speed with which an electromagnetic wave goes through matter is determined by n. You can just do that. Now if the refractive index changes from place to place, then things become more complicated. Okay? So the answer to the question is that you can still do that as a non-interacting thing, because fundamentally it is not interacting. But the electromagnetic radiation is interacting with charged particles and charged particles are producing more electromagnetic interaction. So if you want to think of the final result in terms of the initial results, equations are more complicated. Anything else? Okay, good, thanks.